Let's talk about estimation and prediction using the fitted line in simple linear regression. We're going to discuss two types of problems. The first being estimating the theoretical mean of y at a given value of x, some value of x that is of interest to us. And I'm going to call that value of x, x star. So we want to estimate the mean of y at that given value of x. And we might see this written sometimes as the expectation of y at that given value of x. The other type of problem is predicting a single value of y for that given value of x, for that x star value. And which one of these we're going to use in practice depends on the question of interest in a given setting. A power company may want to estimate the mean daily power consumption for a given temperature, to put in an annual report, say. Or the power company might want to predict power consumption on a single day for a given temperature. They might know a hot day is coming up the next day, have some pretty good idea of what the high temperature is going to be, and they might want to predict power consumption based on that temperature. They might, say, want to be 99.99% sure that they have access to enough power to cover demand. Here's an example I've looked at previously. Pain-related brain activity versus score on the empathic concern scale for 16 women. These women were given a score on the empathic concern scale, our X variable, by answering some questions that helped to measure their empathy towards others. They then watched as their partner had a painful stimulus applied and an MRI measured activation level in the pain centers of the brain, and that was our Y variable. And here we've got our scatter plot for those 16 values with the least squares regression line fit in. Now suppose there was a different woman, one who is not one of these 16 women in the dataset, and we knew that her score on the empathic concern scale was down here at 12, and we wanted to predict her activation level. Well, we could simply go from 12 up to the line and come over here for our predicted value of y. And that would also be the estimated mean of y at x equals 12. And to find either of those, we simply substitute this value of x that is of interest to us into our least squares regression line. Here we have our least squares regression line with that value of x substituted in. We have our estimated mean of y for all the women in our population with an x value of 12. So this is our estimated mean of y when x is equal to 12. And that's simply put into our regression line and we get 0.040. And down here, we may want to predict the value of y for a single woman who has an x value of 12. And for that, we simply substitute that into the regression line and we get the same value, 0.040. And it shouldn't be too surprising that what we feel is a reasonable predicted value is simply the estimated mean at that point. But if we go back up here and look at our estimated mean of y at that given value of x, that is a point estimate. And in the world of statistics, we don't feel that point estimates are all that useful without some measure of the uncertainty associated with that value. And one common way we have of expressing that uncertainty is through a confidence interval. The confidence interval for the true theoretical mean of y at that given value of x has a similar format to things we've seen in the past. We take our best estimator of that true theoretical mean, and we add and subtract this margin of error. And the margin of error is made up of a t-value times the standard error of this estimator. When we're talking about predicting a single value, we use a little bit different terminology. We don't talk about confidence intervals, we talk about prediction intervals. We create confidence intervals for parameters. And when we're predicting a single value, that's not a parameter, so we call it a prediction interval. But overall, the idea is going to be very, very similar here. We take our best prediction and we add and subtract a margin of error. The margin of error is simply made up of our t-value times the standard error of the predicted value. Now I'm using the term standard error a little bit loosely here, because we typically reserve standard error for standard errors of estimators of parameters. But in order for us to see the similarities between these two things, I'm going to call it the standard error. In both cases, the degrees of freedom for that t are just our regular old degrees of freedom for simple linear regression, and that's simply n minus 2. The standard errors are a bit of a hassle to find by hand, so we really should use statistical software. Statistical software will find prediction intervals and confidence intervals for us, and our job will simply be to properly interpret those intervals. But it is useful to know a few things about those standard errors, so let's take a look at them. It's not too difficult to show that the variance of our estimated mean of y at a given value of x is equal to this quantity. The only thing that changes when we change this value of x is this quantity in the numerator here. And this quantity here is going to be smallest when this x star value is equal to x bar, or in other words, the x value of interest is equal to the mean of x, and it's going to get greater and greater the farther away that x value is from the mean of x. As is usually the case, sigma squared is not going to be a known quantity, so we estimate it with s squared, and then we take the square root of that estimated variance, and we call it the standard error. The standard error for the predicted value is going to be a little bit different. It can be shown that the variance of our predicted value is equal to this. And if we break this down a little bit, we'd see that this is the same as what we had on the last page. This is the variance of the estimator of the mean of y at that given value of x. And then we are adding sigma squared. Remember that in a regression analysis, sigma squared represents the variance of y at a given value of x. And to find the standard error, we simply substitute s squared in place of sigma squared, and we take the square root. And that's what we have down here, the standard error of our predicted value. This 1 here comes from the fact that we had this extra sigma squared on the end. Now let's look at the two standard errors we've come up with next to each other. Here we have our standard error of our estimator of the mean of y at that given value of x. And here we have our standard error of a prediction of a single value. And they differ only in this 1 that is here. And that comes from the fact that the y values are assumed to vary about the true regression line with a variance of sigma squared. So there is added extra variability in the prediction of a single value as opposed to estimating the mean of all values at that point. Here I've used software to calculate a confidence interval and prediction interval when x is equal to 12. This first bit is a 95% confidence interval for the true mean of y, or in other words, the mean of y given our x value is 12. And for that, we simply had our estimated mean, as from before, plus and minus this margin of error, which a computer calculated for me. Down here, this is a 95% prediction interval for a single value of y, and we take our predicted value from before, plus and minus the margin of error. Note that the margin of error in a prediction interval for a single value is greater than the margin of error for a confidence interval for the true mean value at that point. Let's take a look at this confidence interval for the mean of y when x is equal to 12 visually. Returning to our example, the green arrow represents the confidence interval for the mean of y when x is equal to 12, the one we just looked at on the last slide. We could calculate a confidence interval for the mean of y at a different point. We might be interested over here, say. That might be the point of interest in a given problem. I've gone ahead and done that for different values of x and plotted it out, so let's take a look. The green curves represent a confidence interval for the mean of y at any specific value of x. So we might be interested here in the mean of y when x is equal to 18 or so, or the mean of y when x is over here at about 22, or whatever the point of interest is to us. Note that the interval is narrowest at the mean of x and then gets wider as we move away from the mean of x. But depending on the scenario, we might not be interested in estimating the mean of all women in our population for a given x value. We might simply be interested in predicting the activation level for a single woman. So if we had a woman over here with a x value of 24 or what have you, we're going to come up with a prediction interval. And that prediction interval for a single woman is going to be a little bit wider than the confidence interval for the mean of y at that point. So I've gone ahead and done that, and that's what that red line represents, the prediction interval for a single value of y when x is equal to 24. And it's a little bit wider than the corresponding confidence interval for the mean. And we could do this at various different values of x as well. So if our point of interest was predicting a single value when x is equal to 18, say, that would be our prediction interval. Or down here at x is equal to 12, that would be our prediction interval. Note that the prediction interval is wider than the corresponding confidence interval. And note also that the prediction interval is narrowest at the mean of x and gets wider the farther away that value of x of interest is from the mean of x. For these methods to be valid, the usual regression assumptions must hold. We need independent observations, a linear relationship between y and x, the variance of the y values to be the same at every value of x, and we need the y values to be normally distributed about the line. Now, very often in statistics, this normality assumption is not all that important if we have a large sample size, as the central limit theorem works its magic. But prediction intervals for a single value are a little bit different. For the prediction interval methods discussed here to be reasonable, we need the y values to be approximately normally distributed. If they're not, and we calculate a prediction interval using the methods here, then the resulting interval may be misleading.